Well, tonight I wanted to share with you some things that I've been kind of experiencing in my own life, and that's what I like to do is just kind of go through what I'm going through. And I know that if I'm going through it, I'm just an average Joe guy, and there's nothing special about me. I'm just some regular dude on the street just like you. And I know that generally when I go through something, you go through something too, because we're all going through it together. Praise God, we're on a journey together. Amen. Ain't nobody in this place has arrived yet. If anybody tells you that they've arrived, don't listen to them, man, because the moment when we're with Jesus, that's the moment we've arrived. So, but I want to talk to you tonight about the subject of living up to expectations. Living up to expectations. And as I was thinking about it, and as I was talking about this idea, and as God, I believe, was speaking in my heart, just some areas of my life of thinking about this subject of living up to expectations, I thought of kind of something funny to start it off. And have you ever just been somewhere that you just, it just changed your life? Maybe it was a restaurant, or maybe you saw that movie, or you went to a play, or something like that, and it was just like, this is the most amazing experience I've ever had, and I have to tell everybody I know about it. Anybody ever been there before? And then what happens when you do that? They go back, and you know, like my parents, I love my parents, my mom and my dad, they're like goldfish. You know, goldfish have like a 2-second memory. And my mom and my dad, you're like goldfish when it comes to restaurants. Not anything else, restaurants. When it comes to the Word of God, they are a gold mine. But when it comes to restaurants, they're a little bit like goldfish. And the reason I say that is because they'll always come back from wherever it is that they went. And I can see my sister Kim and Stacy and Pastor Dan, you're probably all nodding at the same time, because wherever they're at on a weekend that they go out together, dad will come back and he'll tell us, hey, listen. And he'll go like this. He'll go, true story. Let's see, that's when you know that dad's really into it. True story. He'll say, your mom and I went to this little restaurant, this little tiny hole-in-the-wall place, wherever it might be, on the backwoods of San Diego or Los Angeles or Newport or wherever it might be that they were at, somewhere up in Washington. True story, your mom and I, we went to this little tiny place that was totally unexpected, and it was the best food I've ever had in my entire life. And so then, like, we'll try to, like, live in their footsteps, and so then we'll go to the restaurant that was the best food that they've ever had in their entire life, and, like, we'll eat it, and we'll be like, it's really not that good. Have you ever been there in your life where it's just like the expectations are so high that it seems like no matter what you do, it seems like you could just never live up to them? You think about life. Life is all about living up to expectations. I mean, the moment you're born, there's expectations that are placed upon you. The expectations that are placed upon you are you're expected to start growing the moment you're born. And as you start to grow, there's expectations in your growth that are placed upon you. As you start to grow, you're expected to start learning. And as you start learning, you're expected to start maturing. And as you start maturing, you're expected to start developing. And as you start developing, you're expected to start succeeding. And as you start to succeed, you're expected to start sharing your success with everybody else. From the moment you are born, from the moment I was born, no matter what stage of life we're in, no matter where we're at in life, there are expectations on each and every one of us that have been placed upon us in our lives. Expectations aren't a bad thing. It's not a negative thing to live up to expectations in life. But as you know, and as I know, expectations can become a burden in our lives when we start to look around us and we start to judge our lives by the expectations of others. When you start to look at how you are as a father, how you are as a mother, how you are as a grandparent, how you are as an employee, how you are as a brother, how you are as a sister, how you are as an entrepreneur, how you are as a Christian, how I am as a preacher. When we start to look at everybody else's expectations upon us, they become burdensome to us. And it starts this unnecessary cycle of discouragement that we live through because of expectations placed upon us. Now, I probably, some of you came tonight and I'm fully aware of expectations and placed upon us, because many of you, probably most of you, if not all of you, came tonight expecting something from me. Even if you didn't know that I'm the one preaching tonight, you were expecting something from me. You came tonight with expectation. What? Because you didn't come to waste your time. You came expecting from me that I would teach you something out of the Word of God that you could use in your life. You came with great expectation on your life. And let me tell you something. I feel that expectation. But did you know that I also came with expectation from you? Did you know that I expect something out of you whenever I preach? You see, you expect me to prepare, and I expect you to be prepared. So that way, when you hear what God wants me or has pressed upon my heart to teach out of His Word, you're prepared to receive it. So you may not have even realized that as I look at you and as I make eye contact with you, I have expectations on you right now. There's some pressure. I might quiz you tonight. What did I speak on? Expectations. You know what I love? I love watching competitive events, sports. I'm not really a sports guy, but I love it whenever somebody does something extravagant, something significant, like they break a record or they do something that's never been done before. I love the fact that we celebrate that, and it's so cool and so fun. But what I really love about it is the reporter right afterwards when they start asking all the questions of expectation. Many of you today, if you were here on Sunday of last week, probably have an expectation on my part to speak on some level about the New England Patriots. Yes, I had great expectations on Atlanta, but apparently, whatever. God is still in control. You know, I blame Russia. No, but what was funny is I love the reporters. I love the reporters as they were asking Tom Brady at the end of the game last week. Were you expecting? I mean, the time was against you. You guys were, your backs were against the wall. And what is it like, you know, coming back from a 25-point deficit with all of these things? And how do you manage the clock? I mean, how do you carry that expectation on you? I love the reporters' questions because they ask things that the athletes aren't even thinking about. And I remember Tom at the end of the interview, he says, I wasn't looking at the clock. We're not managing time. He's like, you can't manage time. He's like, the only thing we can do is we can focus on the end zone and we can try to get the little ball that we hold in our hand into the end zone. That's the only thing we're thinking about. And they're like, you mean you weren't thinking about how many points you needed to get within how many seconds and how many times? Could you break that down? And he's like, no, I'm trying to score a goal. That's all I'm trying to do. I love it when somebody breaks somebody's record and they're like, man, did you know that you broke the record for it? And you know what the athletes, they almost always say? I was just trying to do the very best I could. And you see, what happens with expectations is expectations become burdensome to us when we begin to compare our lives by the expectations of other people. And tonight I want to look at a story of somebody, and it's a story probably everybody knows. Maybe you don't know the story, but you know the essence of the story. And the story is of a young man, probably in his 19, 20, 21-year-old age. His name is David, and he's up against a giant, and his name is Goliath. Maybe you don't know the story, but you know the story of David and Goliath in the sense that it's the underdog story. And this young guy, his name's David, this young guy is in a season in which there's a great amount of expectation on his life. And I want to just kind of look at as I was reading through the story, it's a fun story to look through. And even when there's stories that we know so much about, it's always so much fun to go back and look at them because there's so many things that you can pull out of stories that you already know because you already know the end. So now you start to look at the details of it. And as I was reading through this, I believe God began to speak some things in my own life and in my own heart that about this story, about expectations. And in essence, as we look at the story, and let me give you the background of it, there's two armies. There's the army of the Philistines, and then there's the army of the Israelites, and they've gathered together. And the Philistines have put out this challenge to the Israelite army, and they say, we've sent our greatest soldier, Goliath, to be the sole representative of our entire army. You send the number one representative of the Israeli army or the Israelite army to fight Goliath, and whoever wins, the losing army will be slaves. It's just a one-on-one battle. Instead of everybody killing everybody, let's just do a grudge match to the death. And you seem to think, okay, well, those are kind of pretty good odds, but the problem is Goliath was a giant. Goliath was huge. Some people say that Goliath had even gone so far as to shave his teeth down to make them point so that if it was hand-to-hand combat, he could bite through the skin of people. And he was probably more than 7 feet tall. Some people say 8 or 9 feet tall. Think of like Andre the Giant. Anybody remember Andre the Giant? Millennials have no clue who he is other than on stickers. Like Andre the Giant. And here's this ruddy, the Bible tells us he was ruddy, kind of good looking, kind of maybe, I think maybe, you know, probably a little cocky, you know, shepherd kid from the hills of Judea. And he comes and he sees Goliath taunting the armies for day after day after day. And literally the army shaking in their boots. And this young guy just says, isn't there a cause? I mean, you guys are a bunch of chickens. You're the army of the Most High God. Nobody's standing up to this big giant. And everybody's like, man, go back to the sheep where you came from. What are you trying to stir up drama with? And David's like, look, I'll fight them. I'll fight Goliath. I mean, it could be that he didn't have to pay taxes. Then he could marry the king's daughter. That's a pretty good incentive, you know. And so David goes before the king. His name is Saul. And David says to Saul, he convinces Saul to let him be the sole representative of the army of Israel against this professional trained warrior, Goliath. And so David tells Saul, listen, I fought a bear before when I was watching sheep, and I killed the bear, and I fought a lion, and I killed the lion when I was watching sheep, and just like that, God will deliver me. And so Saul says, go, do it, be blessed. And it's right at that moment that I want to pick up on expectations in life and how we look at expectations in life. And I want to just see what the Word of God says and what God maybe wants to speak into your heart about living life up to expectations. So go with me to the book of 1 Samuel in the 17th chapter. 1 Samuel chapter 17, and we're going to look at this famous, famous, famous story of David and Goliath. And this is the point that we pick up when David has convinced him to allow him to fight this giant Goliath. And now it's time for David to go. So Saul says to David, go, and the Lord will be with you. And the Lord, may the Lord be with you. And so now in this moment, it says, so Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head, and he clothed him with a coat of mail. And I thought it was so interesting there that David convinces Saul to allow him to be this sole representative in this grudge match to the death. And David is not a trained warrior. David's not a soldier. He wasn't recruited or drafted. David spent most of his time watching sheep on the hills of Judea, playing songs on his harp while he watched the sheep. He was running an errand for his dad, and all of a sudden, in a moment now, he is about to be one of the most watched people in the entire nation of Israel, and thousands and thousands and thousands of people's fate is in this 21-year-old boy's hands. And so Saul says, go. And may the Lord be with you. And as Saul sends or commissions David to be this representative in this grudge match, Saul does something interesting. Saul breaks out his own personal armor, and he starts to clothe David in Saul's armor. He puts on him, you think about it, like the breastplate and the shoulder plate, and he puts on this big bronze helmet. He gives David this chainmail shirt. Now, the thing we need to understand about Saul is that Saul was a big guy. When we read about the story of Saul, it tells us that Saul stood head and shoulders above everybody else in his tribe. So Saul was one of those guys that when you looked at him like this. And so Saul puts his armor on David, and the weight of his armor is on David's shoulders. And I think about it like this, when we look at this and apply this idea to our life, I feel like if there's one thing that I think that this story tells us is that we put undue stress in our lives. When we live our lives and when we try to live our lives according to the expectations of others. Life is fragile as it is. Life is chaotic as it is. I mean, you're not in control of your time. You're not in control of how your children respond. You're not in control of what happens to you at the job. You're not in control of the stock market in which your retirement might be based on. You're not in control of a lot of things in life. There's a lot of things that already happen through the general course of life that causes enough stress on our lives for us to not have to pile it on ourselves by living according to the expectations of others. And so here's this young guy, clearly not as tall as Saul, clearly not as strong as Saul, clearly not as big of a guy as Saul. And Saul starts to put Saul's armor onto David's shoulders. And as we say that expectations of others are a stress or a burden to us, Saul's expectations to David to fight according to the way Saul knew how to fight was a burden, and not just a metaphoric or a physical or mental or spiritual burden, but also a physical burden to David's shoulders. And so we have a tendency in our lives to take this thing called expectation, to take this thing that people expect upon us, what job you're gonna work at, how much money you're gonna make. Think about image. We live in an image society. That's why everybody posts their reel, their highlight reel of the world, so that the world would look at and think that our lives are what everybody else wants in their lives. That's why we have things like Facebook and Instagram and all these different things. You know, we say, oh, it's to tell a story, but we try to tell the story of how great our life is. And what we do is by imagery, we begin to put stress on our lives, undue stress on our lives, because we start living our lives according to the expectations of other people on us. What kind of car could I drive? I'm not successful unless I drive a luxury brand car. I'm not a successful person unless I live on a certain side of the freeway or in a certain zip code. I'm not a good parent unless my kids are in the top 30%, 20%, 10% of their class. I'm not a good Christian unless I go to church every time that the services, the doors are open. And we place these burdens of expectations on our lives that cause undue stress, because we live our lives according to the expectations of others. You know, I think about my own life growing up. Church was growing. You know, the church was growing at a pace that it was ridiculous. You know, there was things happening, and we would go from two services to three services to Sunday night service to Wednesday night service to our Friday night Holy Ghost service in the Teal buildings. And we had all these different things, and the church was growing. And then I went away, and I went to Bible college. And when I came back, we just opened this building with Pastor Dan, Pastor Jess. We all went to Bible college together. And when we came back, this building was brand new and just opened it up. And we had two services, and then we went to three services. And then we had a Sunday night service and a Wednesday night service and a Thursday morning service. And we started all these different things. And I was in the television room. I was in the control room, hidden in the behind the scenes. And I remember there's a likeness to another very prominent preacher who kind of came from the same background. His name's Joel Osteen. Maybe you've heard of him. And his dad, John Osteen, was a dynamic man. And I remember growing up in my teens and in my 20s, with great intentions, people would tell me all the time, Luke, man, you're gonna be the next Joel Osteen. You're gonna be the next Joel Osteen. I can just see it. You know, Joel worked in the video department too. And Joel spent all the time videoing his daddy's messages too. And he learned all the things that he learned from watching his daddy John in the control room. And you're just walking the same path that Joel Osteen would walk. And I can't wait, Luke, to see you become the next Joel Osteen. And they'd walk out of the church excited because they encouraged a 21-year-old kid. And I don't know if you've looked around. It's a big church, but it's not the compact center in Houston. I don't have 28 million viewers watching me every week. As a matter of fact, that went on YouTube. Only 120 people watched last week's message on YouTube. And the pressure of myself through the course of my 20s to live up to the expectations of what people would put on me with every good intention, with words of encouragement. I'm just telling you, you're gonna be great. And I'm like, I'm just a regular guy off the street. I've got my questions just like you do. Can put undue stress in our lives. And life is full of enough stress. Life is full of enough pressure that we don't need to add it to ourselves by trying to live up to the expectations of others. Maybe growing up, if you're young, maybe growing up, the expectation put upon you was to go to college or to go to a certain college, to work a certain career field by your parents. Your parents wanted the best for you. They wanted the most for you. And they said, you ought to do this, and I wish you'd do that, and I hope you do that. Maybe the expectations were to have good grades. Maybe the expectations were to have a great marriage. Maybe the expectations on you were to have kids so that your parents could have grandparents. Maybe the expectations were to retire with some money and move to another state or move to another place. Maybe the expectations were to be the husband that your wife saw on TV in the movies. Maybe your expectations were to be the wife that your husband saw when he looked at all of his friends and what they were doing, their friends' wives were looking. And you put undue stress in your lives because of the expectations of somebody else. And you put physical, literal, spiritual, and emotional weight, just like I did, on your lives because somebody wanted you to look some way that you knew wasn't you. For me, I had to come to the realization, I'm not Joel Osteen. I don't want to be Joel Osteen. I could try to be Joel Osteen. Oh, praise God. I tell you, my daddy, when he would teach. No, I can't do it. Joel Osteen's an amazing guy. He is an inspiration to every young pastor to look at somebody and say, look what God can do. But I'm not Joel Osteen. You're not your parents. You're not your neighbor's spouse. You're not that TV couple. You're not the person down the street. You're not your employer or your boss. You're you. Amen. And when you live your life according to the expectation that somebody else puts upon you, you're adding undue stress, like Saul loaded David down with the armor of Saul. Why? Because Saul wanted David to go out and fight like Saul. But David didn't learn how to fight like Saul. David learned how to fight like David. And see, what happens in our lives is we look at things like the Constitution. What a great thing. And the Declaration of Independence. And there's this amazing phrase that we look at and we only say half of it. And we say that we're all created equal. And so because of equality, we look at somebody else and we say, anything you can do, I can do better. Because God made us equal. But what we fail to realize in the course of American history is in that preamble of the Constitution and in the Declaration of Independence, there's a comma and the words say, in that equality, we all as humanity have unalienable rights. Amen. You see, God created us equal, I agree with our founding fathers, equal in the terms of human rights. There is not one person that should have more rights than another because of their race, because of their background, because of their belief system. That is what our nation was found on. But God did not create us equally. And that's a hard thing for us to get a hold of. Because we live in a society that gives everybody a trophy for participating. We want everybody to feel good about themselves. We don't want anybody to be in last place and everybody to be in some place together. That's the society because of equality. But you see, what we have to realize is look around. Just take 3 seconds to look around the auditorium. Just look around. Don't look at me. Look around. You're looking at me. Look around. I really want you to look around. What do you see? Different people. You see, God created us equal in that we all have unalienable rights of humanity. But God did not create us equally. Which means that there are people that are going to be able to do things you can't do. And there are going to be people that you can do things that they can't do. And when we try to live our lives according to the expectations of what somebody who was created to do something we can't do, and we try to do what they do, even though we can't do it, we put undue stress and undue burden in our lives, and we stop trying to be who God created us to be, and we start looking around from the left and to the right, and we say, I want to look like that. I want to be like that. I want to act like that. I want to think like that. I want to be that person in the body of Christ. But God created you to be none other than you. So why are we trying to live up to other people's expectations? Why do we try so hard to live up to other people's expectations? Look what it says going on in the story. 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. So Saul put on the armor, he put on the chainmail, he gave him a helmet. 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. And David, he fastened his sword, Saul's sword, to his armor, and he tried to walk. See, David didn't try. He didn't outright say no. Saul said, David, go, but I want you to look like me. I want you to fight like me. David, here's my helmet. Here's my my breastplate. Here's my shoulder pads. Here's my chainmail. Here's my sword. Put it on your belt. Now stand up. David, get out there and fight Goliath and look like a champion. And it says David tried. He took Saul's sword and he put it on the belt. And he started to walk. And I get this image of David like walking, like buckling under the pressure of the chainmail. You see, for a moment there, David tried. He tried to accept Saul's expectations, and I don't think Saul was trying to do anything but to help David. David, you want to go fight Goliath? Where's your armor? I don't have any armor. Here's mine. Take it. Where's your sword? I don't have a sword. I only have a stick. You know what? Here's my sword. Take it. Saul was trying to help David, but David had to come to the realization that David could not fight like Saul. David had to fight like David. And you're not created to be your parents. Why? Because there's two parents. Did you ever notice that? That if you were created, if I was created to be just like Pastor Jim Colbray, then I would only just need to be a clone of Pastor Jim Colbray. But then there's this problem is I got a Pastor Deborah Colbray. And then on top of Pastor Deborah Colbray, I got a lesson of Lori Larson that's in there. And I've got a Rudy and an Ellen Colbray that's in there. And then go on and on and on. You were not created to be a mimic of the person that put their expectations on you. You don't need to live your life according to other people's expectations, even when they're the best and even when they're for you. Listen, expectations are not a bad thing. They help us crawl out of the pit sometimes in life when we know that somebody expects us and has confidence in us to do better and to be more. But when we put our lives and when we begin to judge our lives according to somebody else's expectations, that's when we put undue stress and undue burden in our own lives. And I don't believe that's God's call for you. I don't believe that's God's call for me. And we can spend the course of our entire lives trying to live up to somebody's expectation, trying to look like what somebody said we should look like, trying to act like what somebody said we should act like, trying to think like somebody said we should think like. When God said, I created you to be you. Paul the Apostle tells us in 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, that if everybody was the same thing, then there would be no diversity. And he says, and he paints the picture of a body, and he says, look, not everybody can be the eyeball. Not everybody can be the nose or the mouth. Not everybody can be the finger. Somebody's got to be the pancreas. Somebody's got to be the little pinky toe. What is it for? Nobody knows, but somebody's got to do it. Somebody's got to be a part of the body. Why? Because there's unity and diversity. Why? Because it's the diversity that God created us to be. That when we come together and we live who God called us to be according to God's expectations in our lives, now all of a sudden God says, not everybody looks like this, not everybody thinks like this, not everybody acts like this, not everybody hopes like this, not everybody walks like this, not everybody talks like this, but when we all gather together, there's a beauty in unification because we all come together and our gifts and our talents and our abilities work in unison together. And we accomplish something great for the kingdom of God. But God did not call us to all be exactly the same. It's the same thing in churches. There's churches all across the Inland Empire that are meeting tonight. Some of them meet and they have different methods and they have different thoughts and they have different processes. But God put in them to be different than us, and we're not better than them. They're not better than us. Just because we're different doesn't make us anything better or any less. Why? God created the rock to be the rock. God created Marcos up the street on the way to be the way. God created Pastor Rob Zinn in Highland, Emmanuel Baptist, to be the way. God created Pastor Greg Laurie at Harvest to be the way they are. Why? Because we don't all have to look the same. I should get an amen from somebody in this place today. And when we begin to realize in our lives that we don't need to spend the course of our lives living up to somebody else's expectation, there's an immense amount of freedom in that realization. And simply today, as we look at David's story, if you know the story, it goes on. In verse number 39, David tried on and he tried to walk. And he says to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I've not tested them." So David took them off. David took them off. You see, if we would just spend less time trying to live up to other people's expectation and more time living up to God's expectations, what could our lives amount to? You see, you could spend your entire life trying to live according to somebody else's expectations. But I say this, stop trying to live your life according to somebody else's expectations. Stop spending time living according to somebody else's expectations on you, and start spending time living up to God's expectation. Because you see, David had expectations. God had implanted expectations on David's heart to kill Goliath long before Goliath was ever a problem in front of David. Because David was on the hillside of Judea when he was watching sheep, and a lion came, and there was nobody there to give David their armor. There was nobody there to give David their weapon. There was only David and his slingshot and God. And God sent David through and he killed the lion, and then a bear came, and nobody was there to put their armor on David and say, "Okay, David, there's a bear in the woods. Here's how you should do it." David had himself, he had his slingshot, and he had God. And God was preparing for David to fight Goliath the way God wanted David to fight Goliath long before Goliath was ever a problem in David's eyes. And just like that for you, God has expectations for you. He's preparing for you to live according to the will he has set before you long before you even realized or understood what God wanted and has for you. God had expectations of where you would go and what you would do. And if we would just learn to spend a little bit less time worrying about what everybody else expects of us and a little bit more time thinking about what God expects of us, what could we amount to in life? David took off Saul's armor. Think about it. Could David have won against Goliath if he would have fought like Saul? Why do we spend so much time in our lives trying to be like somebody else? When God anointed David to be David, God called you to be you. God gave you a gift in your life. He's called you for a purpose. You're not meaningless. You're not worthless. But at some point in our lives, when our walk with God, it doesn't matter if you're 80 or if you're 18. At some point in our lives, if we would just take the blinders off of what everybody else expected us, maybe it was somebody who's long gone from this earth, but their voice still echoes in your head what they expected of you. And every day you think, "I hope I can live up to what they wanted of me." And to open our eyes like David, to take off the expectations that somebody else has put upon us, and to say, "That's not me. That's not me." Could David have beat Goliath if he would have fought like Saul? No. So what did he do? He took off Saul's armor and he put on his own. And what did he do? Look what it says. What is David's armor? The next verse, it goes on, verse number 40. Then David, remember, Saul put on chainmail, he put on armor, he put on a helmet, and he gave him a sword. Verse number 40. Then David, he took his staff, his shepherd's crook, his stick, and he chose for himself smooth stones from the brook, some rocks. And he put them in a bag which he had, and he took his sling in his hand, and he drew near the Philistine. See, there's so much freedom when we recognize that if we would walk according to the expectations of God and not men, there is freedom. Because don't you know that every eye of the army of Israel was watching David as he walked out there without a sword in his hand to fight the greatest warrior the Philistine army had? Don't you know every person had an expectation as David was walking past them and the murmuring was going on, this is the guy, this is the guy, this is the guy. And as David walked out from Saul's tent, from Saul's camp, past the regiments of soldiers to the front line of the battlefield, and as he began to walk out alone and he faced that man Goliath, and Goliath said to David, what am I, a dog, that you would send a child before me that would come at me with sticks? And David had immense freedom to know that I didn't come at you with armor from somebody else. I'm not coming at you in this life with expectations of somebody else. There's freedom in the fact that I'm living my life according to the expectations of God. Because as I live my life according to the expectations of God, it doesn't matter what I look like to anybody else. And he went out there with a stick in his hand, with a rock in his bag, and a sling on his belt. And you know what he did? He shot a rock into the forehead of that dude, and it sunk right in between his eyes, and Goliath didn't even know what hit him, and it fell to the ground, and David charged that man, and he took Goliath's own sword, and he cut off Goliath's head with Goliath's own sword, and the entire army of the Israelites chased the Philistines down. Why? Because they're is freedom when we learn to live according to the expectations of God and not according to the expectations of others. Paul the Apostle struggled with his own expectations. In Romans, he says, I don't know what's going on. The things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't do, I want to do. Who's going to save this wretched man that I am? And then he realizes that if I live in the expectations of Jesus Christ, and if I take one step at a time in the expectations of Jesus Christ, I might fall, I might take a step back, I might get knocked down, but if I get up and I keep my mind focused on the expectations of God, spiritually minded, and not on the expectations of man, carnally minded, that if I take one step and the next step and the next step, Paul begins to realize, and his great eight, Romans the eighth chapter tells us in the 31st verse, Paul begins to say, and if God be for me, who can be against me? Why? Because I'm not walking in my own expectations, because I'll never add up to myself. I'll never be good enough to somebody else. When I look across the aisle, when I look across the street, when I look on social media, when I look in the mirror, I'm never good enough. But if I take one step in the expectations of Christ, and I take another step in the expectations of Jesus, and I take another step in the expectations of Jesus, like David, I can grab my stick, I can grab my stones, I can grab my sling, and everybody might say, you look a little weird, you're a little unconventional, you're a little bit funky, nobody else looks like you look, nobody else talks like you talk, nobody goes to the school or didn't go to the school you went to, you're the first person that didn't, or you're the first person that did. And you can say, like David said, you come at me with swords and spears, the expectations of men, but I come at you with the armies of the living God. And if God is for me, if God is for you, who can be against you? But we just have to learn to stop burning our lives trying to live up to the expectations of everybody else. Don't let commercials dictate you the quality of life. Let Jesus Christ dictate to you the quality of life. Don't let education systems dictate to you the purpose of life. Let Jesus Christ dictate to you the purpose of life. Why? Because there is freedom when we walk in the expectations of God to be who God has called us to be. And God did not call you to look like anybody else on earth except you. And when you do, you can accomplish great things in life. Because God, expectation, what is expectation? It's a confidence. And God has an expectation for you. You can look at that as a weight, or you can say it like this. God has a confidence in you. God has a confidence in you to achieve what He destined you to achieve. The way He destined you to achieve it. But you got to do it for Him and not for anybody else. And if you do, I'll tell you what, God will move in your life. As we close today, maybe there are some of you in this place that you've been living under the heavy weight, the stress, and the burdens of expectations of others. You say, I'm tired of the stress that I've put on myself. I'm tired of living according to the expectations of somebody else in my life. I just want to live according to the expectations of God, and I want prayer in that. Today, I believe the Spirit of God wants to speak to you tonight, and if that's you, would you just do me a favor? Would you stand to your feet? If that's you, say, you know what? I'm tired of living under the weight of expectations of somebody else, and I need prayer in my life. I want encouragement today. If that's you in this place, would you stand to your feet? All over this place. Don't let expectations stop you from being free of expectations. That's how intertwined they are. I'm just going to ask if you would, just would you raise your hands to God and let's go before God today. Let's ask Him to be our deliverer today. Father, for each and every one of these people that's in this place today, for each and every person that's in this place today that's been feeling the weight of expectation on their lives, and I know that many of the expectations of which we live under are for great intentions, through no fault of somebody else. But somehow we've allowed them to be a burden to us, to put a pressure on us. Lord, I pray tonight for deliverance of the burdens, for deliverance of the chain, for the deliverance of the weight that living according to somebody else's expectations would bring. And for each and every person tonight that is standing and reaching out to you, God, I pray that your Holy Spirit right now would minister them peace, would minister to them comfort, would minister to them your confidence, your expectation, your will, your desire, your pleasure, your love for them where they're at. God, that they would look around and they would realize that they don't have to wear the expectations of somebody else, but they could remove those weights and, Lord, they could step out in the freedom to be who you have called them to be. So, Father, tonight, Lord, we give that weight to you today. Like David, who removed the armor of Saul to face Goliath the way you intended him to do. Lord, tonight we remove the weight of expectations and we walk out of this room tonight the way you intended us to face life, Lord. And I pray that you would reveal through your Holy Spirit, your will, your plan. God, I pray as we pray, Lord, I pray as we seek after you, Lord, as I pray as we get close to you, God, your heart, your spirit would speak to us and give us direction like David on the hills of Judea, Lord, that you would formulate and form our lives and our paths wherever we are in Jesus' mighty name. We all together said, amen. Amen. Praise God. Will somebody give the Lord praise tonight? Hey, before we leave tonight, I want to just take one more quick moment, a few quick moments, and talk to you about expectations when it comes to your relationship with God through Jesus Christ. You see, so often we have expectations in life. We expect things to happen in our lives. And many times in life, our expectations are founded on wrong assumptions or pretenses. And today I want to give you the opportunity to examine your heart, to examine your life as to where you are and where you stand with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. See, Paul the Apostle encourages us in the church in 1 Corinthians 11 chapter. He tells us, if you just examine yourself from time to time, if you just take a look at your life and be honest with yourself, you wouldn't be judged like everybody else would be judged because you'd be honest. And I want to just take that moment of honesty Take a moment of intimacy right now with God, between you and God. And I want you to ask yourself, where are you in your relationship with God? One of the ways, like Pastor Dan said it this weekend, one of the ways you can locate where you are with God is by asking this question. If you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? It's kind of a blunt question, but the question persists. What would happen to you after you die? Heaven forbid that be the case tonight. See, many times our expectations or our assumptions are, well, I hope I'd go to heaven. I want to go to heaven. I think I'd go to heaven. Many times our assumptions or our pretenses are, because I go to church, I'm here tonight. People who go to church go to heaven. My expectation is I went to church as a child. I was baptized or christened, or I received communion, or whatever it might be. That means that everything's good between me and God, and I'm going to get to heaven. Yeah, praise God, I'm good with that. And we live our life according to these expectations, thinking everything's good and everything's grand and everything's right. When the truth of the matter is that God's word is very clear and very concise as to what it takes and what it means for us to be in connection and unison with God, to the place that we find eternal life with God through His Son, Jesus Christ, in heaven. And it doesn't come by hoping. It doesn't come by wanting. It doesn't come by a positive thought. It doesn't come by a wish. It doesn't come by church attendance, as much as we'd love to think that the more we attend church, as long as we have a gold star record in our church attendance, that that's good. It doesn't come by the fact that we do good deeds, that we stand for social justice, that we give to charitable organizations like the Red Cross, or we don't cheat on our taxes. It doesn't come from the fact that we have a membership card to a church in our wallet, and that we belong to a body. It doesn't come by the fact that we volunteered, or we've carried the pastor's Bible, or we were ushers or children's ministry workers in our last church. It doesn't come through any of those things. And it certainly doesn't come through a sense of spirituality. Well, you know what? I believe in a God, and I believe in a higher power, and I believe that there's some kind of thing, whatever, if you want to call it heaven, you can call it heaven, whatever you want, and we'll all kind of get there the same. You have your thought, and I have my thought, and it all, everybody kind of thinks the same thing with just different titles. I love you enough, respect you enough today to tell you the truth. That's not what God's word says. It's very clear. You see, Jesus Christ says this. He says that He, and He alone, is the way, the truth, and the life. And He says no one will go to the Father in heaven except through Him. It's not a system of hopes or beliefs. It's not a system of outward actions. It's not a system of spirituality. It's not a way of what you do. The only way you and I can spend eternity with God in heaven is through a relationship with His Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus was speaking in John the 3rd chapter to a religious man. His name's Nicodemus. Nicodemus asks Jesus this question at night. He says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" More specifically, Jesus just gives him the answer, and He says, "Nicodemus, in order to inherit," what is an inheritance? Who does an inheritance belong to? To somebody within, somebody in a family, somebody who is part of a circle. And Jesus says, in order to inherit eternal life, He says, you must be born again. What does that mean, born again? We think of what Hollywood and society and sitcoms have made it out to be, you know, that weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity that nobody really wants to admit that they're a part of. Listen, that's not what Jesus is talking about. You see, simply put, to be born again, as Jesus says it like this, what is born of the flesh is flesh, our lives. What is born of the Spirit is spirit. There's a spirit man on the inside of you. It's that person that when you look in the mirror and you know the depths of where you are, nobody knows you like you know you. That's the spirit on the inside of you. And Jesus says, until that man on the inside spiritually is born again with your heart and with your life, you'll not inherit eternal life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. So often people think, well, you know, I believe in Jesus. I believe that He existed. That's great. That's wonderful. It's a historical fact that Jesus existed. Simply believing in the existence of Jesus does not suffice for salvation. See, the devil in hell and the demons in hell believe in the existence of Jesus. They even quote the Word of God. They knew Him. They recognized Him. They called Him Son of David, which was a messianic spiritual term, but that doesn't mean that they're going to heaven. That doesn't mean that they're right with God. You see, you could have a carnal knowledge all about Jesus. You could know all about who Jesus is, and you could miss out on a relationship with Jesus. Think about it like this. You know, everybody in America knows, you know who the President of the United States is. You know the address of the house in which he lives. Maybe you don't know that, but you know it's in Washington, D.C., and you know that it's white. But you don't know him personally. He's not calling you, inviting you over for dinner tonight, because there's a difference between knowing all about something and knowing somebody personally. so often that's how much we miss God, is the distance between our head and our heart, that we have a carnal knowledge of who God is, and God says, that's not what I'm after. I'm after a heart understanding and relationship with me. See, it's an all or nothing relationship. Jesus in the book of Revelation is speaking to a church, people who are religious, people who are following him, people who are his disciples. And he says this word. He says, I'd rather find that you're hot, I'd rather find that you're cold, because he says, if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus, and it's designed to get your attention. As you read that, or as you hear somebody say that, you say, what did he just say? Exactly. And what Jesus is saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all. You're not going to make it. God forgive American churches that we've been more interested in the expectations of numbers than the condition of the hearts of the seats, of the people in the seats. And today, I love you enough and respect you enough to tell you the truth today. You're not going to make it because you hope so. You're not going to make it because you want to. You're not going to make it because you wish. You're not going to make it because you attend church. You're not going to make it because you have a token prayer, a cross, or a crucifix around your neck. You're not going to make it because your parents told you you were a Christian growing up, or because you marked on a census. The only way you and I can be sure without a shadow of a doubt that we're going to make it into heaven is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus said he gave us his Holy Spirit as a stamp of approval in us so that we could walk around life without any question of who God is through us. And if you're walking through life today, lukewarm, occasional church attendance, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing, not wholehearted for God, not wholehearted against God, kind of somewhere in the middle, playing the game, doing your own thing, listen, that's not you today. You're not going to make it, but that does not have to be your future. That does not have to be your destiny. Why? Because you can start today living the expectations of God in your life, and that is a wholehearted, a fulfilling relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus told us about heaven. He says, I have come that you would have life. Praise God, eternally. But he says, I come that you would have life and have it abundantly. It's a great thing to think about where we go when we die, but it's not all about that. Jesus says, I came that you would have life here on earth with me today. A fulfilling relationship with Jesus Christ. God the Father, the creator of the universe, the one that holds the world in his hands, wants to know you intimately. And get this, he wants you to know him intimately through his son. You see, in that same statement about hot and cold, Jesus says to the church, he says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, if you just open the door, he says, I'd come in and we'd have communion. I'd dine together with you. We'd have a relation together and I'd be with you and you'd be with me and we'd be together. Today, I believe that the Spirit of God's knocking on the door of your heart today. And as you take a moment to examine your heart, as you take a moment to examine your life, what is the Spirit of God saying to you? Is he drawing you? Is he beckoning you? Is he inviting you into a life relationship with him through his son, Jesus Christ? Today, if that's you, I want to give you the opportunity to respond. Here's what we'll do in just a moment. I'm going to go like this. I'll count to three. I'll go like this. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing today is you're saying, by the raising of your hand, you're saying, you know what, today I want to make the decision to follow Jesus. Pastor Luke, I feel like what you're talking about today, I feel like what you've been talking about tonight is speaking to me right where I'm at. I feel like there's just something in me that God wants me to respond. And today I want to respond to the invitation of God. If that's you today, in just a moment, you raise your hand. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. You see, Jesus said these words. He said that if you'd confess him before men, he'd confess you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him, he'll deny you. The decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He won't force his way or make his way. He's done everything he can by sending Jesus, his only begotten son, to die on a cross for your and my sin and shame so that we could be in communion and covenant and relationship with Jesus today. Look, there's that emptiness on the inside and you've been trying to fill that with expectation. There's that void on the inside. You've been trying to fill that with relationship, with title, with money, with possessions. But it's a hole on the inside of you that was designed to be filled by God himself through Jesus Christ. And will you today receive the invitation and respond to the invitation of the Holy Spirit today, saying, come and receive life through Jesus Christ today? If you raise your hand, I'll see it in just a moment. You can put it right back down. And right after that, what we're going to do is I'm going to pray a prayer with you together, a prayer of salvation. And by raising your hand, you're saying, you know what, Pastor Luke, that's me. I want to pray that prayer today. All over this auditorium, I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus, if that's you in just a moment, come on, make that choice today. If you're not sure, don't walk out of this place without making sure. That's a gamble on your life you cannot afford to make. You do not know what tomorrow holds. So today, make sure. If you've been living lukewarm, you've been playing the church game, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, been riding the fence a little bit here, a little bit there, listen, that does not have to be your destiny with God. Today is the day for you to make a decision, to turn your life around, to receive Jesus Christ and to go forward in all that he has for you today? Will you respond to the invitation of the Holy Spirit? I'm going to count to three, and as I do, if that's you, you pop your hand up. I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there, all over this place. If that's you, from the front row to the back row, this is your moment, this is your time. Today is the day of your salvation. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. If that's you, say, I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus. That's you in this place today. Ushers are pointing over there. Wait, I see you, my man. All right, got you. Anybody else in this place? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes. The Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. Will you respond? I see you, sister. Anybody else in this place? I see you right there. Good. Three wise people. Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. Will you respond to God? You're not responding to a man. You're responding to God. Is that you today? Let the Spirit of God speak to you. If that's you, would you receive life in Jesus Christ? Anybody else in this place today? Three wise people. Didn't embarrass them. Not here to embarrass you. Anybody else today? Anybody else today? Well, praise God. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Three's great. Phenomenal. Here's what we're going to do. You said, I'm going to pray a prayer, and I want to pray that prayer with you. I want to shake your hand. I want to congratulate you. I want to look you in the eyes, and so I'm not going to do anything other than that. I'm going to pray with you. All right? I want to ask you to do something in a moment. We're all going to stand. If you raise your hand, or you should raise your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible. A friend, if you need a friend, if you came with somebody, look at them and say, hey, come on, will you go with me? Or say, hey, come on, I'll go with you. Let's go together. I want you to get out of your seat, get into the aisle, come meet me right here. Let me shake your hand, and let's pray that prayer of salvation together. Let's change destinies together right where you're at. So let's all stand to our feet. Elijah's going to sing a song. If that's you, you come. Come meet me up here today, and let's change destinies together. If that's you. Congratulations. Just hang out right here. We're going to pray, okay? But if that's you, you come. Was shed for me. Hey, my man, great job. Congratulations. Just hang out right here. We're going to pray together. Just hang out right here. If that's you, yeah, you come. This is your moment. This is your time. It's not too late. You can respond to God today. Sister, congratulations. Great job. Hey guys, listen, I want to just tell you something. First and foremost, let me be the first person, maybe today, maybe ever, I don't know, but maybe today, that tells you, good job. Good job. You're doing a good job. Say, you don't know my life. You don't know if I've done anything. No, you're making the greatest decision you can possibly make in your life today. Good job. Good job. It doesn't matter what happened yesterday. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. And here's what we're going to do today. We're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. You don't get saved by repeating some magical formula. It's not that easy, okay? You get saved by believing in your heart, using your mouth to say what's in your heart. So I'm going to give you some words to say, but I don't want them to be my words. I want them to be your words, okay? So I'm going to lead you in a prayer, and with your heart, you use your heart to believe them. You use your mouth to say it. Repeat it after me. It's very simple. We're going to go before the Lord, and we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together today. And you know what? Everybody's going to join in so we can all do it together, so you're not alone, all right? So let's all bow our heads. Let's all close our eyes. Close our eyes, and you guys up here in front, especially up front, but you all out there today, and if you're at home watching on the live stream, you also, let's pray this prayer together. Repeat these words after me. Father God, I come to you today, and I acknowledge today I need you, and today I respond to your invitation to your family. I give my heart, I give my life over to you. Today, I commit my life to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ. I ask that you would forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of my past. And I dedicate my future to you. Fill me with your Spirit today. Speak to me your expectations today. From this day forward, I'll follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Great job. Really quickly, see this guy right over here in the leather jacket? super cool guy. I mean, this guy is probably one of the coolest guys here at the church. His name is Joel. Joel wants to take you guys just right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on, I promise. He wants to give you some information just to point you in the right direction. You're starting a new journey, so he wants to point you in the right direction. Where do you start? How do you do that? So he's going to give you some free information. He's going to connect you with somebody here at the church that'll pray with you. They'll connect with you. They'll invite you to come back to teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God. So he's even got a comic book for you so that you can read a cool comic book, all right? So he wants to get you connected on your journey. So if you just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Praise God.